across the country now have programs for governors. Because they come with profound needs that a lot of, for example, I had a veteran in one of my programs, and she had to be escorted to and from my class because she couldn't walk with the threat of any dark light. So these are accommodations that when they're in college, they have, and our center makes those accommodations. Yes, because a lot of them come back with post-traumatic stress based on having things happen. And I would never imagine that somebody couldn't walk down a hallway with the threat of darkness. But our program had, they sent over somebody to walk her to and from class every single time. So thank you.
Hi. Nice to meet you all. I'm Tiana Garate. As Dr. Joseph said, I'm a recruiter from the Charter College of Education since April.
Yay!
Before that, I was at the Veterans Research Center since the center opened fall 13. I'm a veteran myself. I went in the Marine Corps right after high school. So I basically had my summer fun, turned 18, and went into boot camp. A lot of people like to ask me why the Marine Corps out of all branches. Particularly because I'm female, right? And so that wasn't the original plan. I was going to go to the Navy because my cousin had been in the Navy for like 8 years. She loved it. And she only got out because she had her son and she hated being deployed from him for so long. So my original thought was to join the Navy. And then one of the girls in my homeroom, she hooked up with them. Not hooked up. I mean, you know, she met a Marine. Not like that. She met a Marine Corps recruiter. And my recruiter was like, he could talk. Like, you know, how they say, you could talk someone from Alaska to buy nice cones or something. He could just talk. So he had the gift, and I made the mistake of going in, not the mistake. I went and met him, and there, next, you know, signing paperwork, and there I went. But my daddy was an Army Korean War vet, so when I came back, and I didn't come back from boot camp, I didn't take no break, I never came home for like about a year. So when I finally came home, he was like, I'm so proud of you, but why the Marine Corps out of all branches? And I said, because I had to talk to you, Daddy, and he was like, call me not so nice he was. But so, like many bits, I went straight into the military because I really didn't see college as an option at the time. I ditched every chance I could get. I only graduated because my recruiter said I did community service with him, which I never did, but you know, because you could only miss, what, 20 days of senior year or something? I don't know if that's changed at the time. I graduated in 1999, so I just did not care to go to school at the time, so that's why I just figured out joining the military. I saw a lot of my friends going into college, either community college or here at Cal State LA, and they were just not doing well because they weren't prepared. And you know, most of us vets here on campus came from the areas and our first generation students, you know, that just don't know too much about financial aid and how to like get through college. So I went 4 years to the Marine Corps and I discharged. They sent me, that's, you know, 9/11 happened and I didn't expect that, you know, when I went in that nothing was going on, it was calm. So when I got deployed overseas and went to the desert, I was there about 6 months when I said, yeah, I think I'm gonna get out when I come back. I do not feel like doing that again. Like, I'm good, I had my experience, got my honorable discharge, you know, got out. And I still wasn't ready for school. I had no motivation to go to school. I bartended for too many years. Enjoy it, it's a lot of fun, but you know. And then I had my son. And that was really my motivation to say, oh God, I better go to school or something. Nobody wants to be a 40-year-old bartender. Like, I'm sorry, that's true. So then I actually, it was 2009 when I started trying to go back to school. I went at ELAC. And then I didn't know about education benefits. All I was aware of it was the original GI Bill, which is, the original GI Bill doesn't pay for, I'm lying, I went to IT Tech a couple years prior when I was still bartending. And it's expensive school, I'm nothing transferred here, it was a waste of time, but the GI Bill at the time, the original GI Bill did not cover tuition. So they just gave you a monthly stipend every month and you had to pay for tuition or figure it out, right? And so when I went back, I figured I'll go to community college, I'm not gonna go to private school, I went to community college, I wanted ELAC. And they had just opened up their little Veterans Research Center. And it was just a couple students running it. I mean, they weren't given any funds or anything. And that's kind of the case across the nation, unfortunately. And so then I found out about the post 9/11 GI Bill, which paid your tuition and gave you a housing stipend. And so I was like, oh, well, yeah, now I could afford school. So fast forward a couple years, I was going to accounting. You know, I like math, but. And so next thing you know, I met one of my good friends that I went to high school with. I actually got him to join the Rinker with me. And he was finishing our counseling program here at Rehabilitation Services. So I met with the advisor, decided I fell in love with the major next year and I was here. But that kind of took me a very long time to figure everything out, you know. I've just finished my second year of my master's in rehabilitation counseling, and I'm just going to extend for another year and do the licensing courses towards the LPCC to practice mental health. So, like, my story is not unusual. It's very, actually, we have vets coming back, and they're much older, don't even qualify for education benefits half the time because they pass the time. And I don't know if you guys recently seen Congress is passing something to extend GI Bill benefits. Because right now, like the original GI Bill, if you didn't use it after 10 years after you got out, you didn't get it anymore. And then most of the older vets, they didn't qualify for this new post 9/11 GI Bill. You have to have served after 9/11. So I'm gonna just, I didn't have a chance to skinny this down like I really would have wanted to. But now that I know I'm talking to what population, I should have probably asked Dr. Joseph Jr. But, you know, so really, I think a lot of you guys are working with students that are considering military, and you want to really help them and guide them in the right place. Knowing who to refer them to would be, like, the number one, right? And so before, I would say what I tell my family members or whoever's kid is considering the military is don't just go and run and talk to a recruiter. Talk to a vet. Talk to a vet. Look at the specific job position you want. When I joined, I didn't even care what I was going to be. I just said, I want to go. I don't even care. And big, huge mistake. I ended up getting a contract for a field. 1,100 fields, so all these different jobs within either communications or electrician. My recruiter had big communications, and he says they get promoted fast because it depends on what job you have in the military, on how fast you get promoted and all this other stuff. So he said, I'm in communications. I get promoted fast, blah, 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 blah. Okay, well, he couldn't secure me in communications, so I ended up, they call it open contract for 1,100 field. I ended up with the electrician side of it because that's where they needed people. I hated it. Absolutely hate it. Like, as long as I have power, I don't care if you don't have power. Like, I can care less. I'm not going to go try to fix it. I'll pay somebody to do it. Like, it's, I realize how much I hate that. One thing I did learn from the military was no matter what I do in my life, I have to absolutely love it or I'm completely miserable. That was my big takeaway from the military. Because for a while, they sent me to do hazmat, hazardous materials. And I loved it. They were sending me to Cal State Fullerton for some California certifications, and then they sent me out to Kuwait, and there went that. But that's the only time I really enjoyed in the Marine Corps because I enjoyed what I was actually doing. So definitely they're considering have them, like, research jobs, and not every branch has everything. Like, for instance, Marine Corps don't have dental and medical. A lot of people want to go into the medical field. They want to do that. So the Marine Corps ain't for you. They don't have that. So definitely, I would say have them research the positions, talk to somebody who was in that branch for that job, those kind of things, because that's how you're really going to help. They go talk to a recruiter, the recruiter's going to promise them everything under the sun, and, you know, they'll end up with a job that I have. So I'm going to go briefly over some education benefits, but just to give you kind of a little background, so most of our vets are either in Texas or in California. California is the biggest, and that's because we have so many stations here, so people just like the weather, end up just discharging here and staying in California. That has residency issues down the road when it comes to education, but we'll talk about that later. So it's actually 11%, so about 23,000 a year from California, their home after serving military bases in our state. And then, so just to kind of give you like a national level, of military status, and in Cal State LA, the last I checked, it was about 750. Now, mind you, that's dependents too, so vets, we probably have about 500 on campus right now. This is just standard. No surprise there. So depending on eligibility, a lot of, so the transition from the military, people really don't, they don't transition you well. So you get out and you kind of just fall on your face, basically. That's what I compare it to, because nobody really sits you down and talks to you about, they're doing a better job since I got out in 2003. They didn't tell me, for instance, I could get unemployment benefits. Like, I just figured I couldn't. A lot of vets come to school, they figure they don't qualify for financial aid. That's so wrong. And so then there's educational benefits, health benefits, and of course, burial benefits at the National VA. And so I'll briefly go over these because I think it's way too much information. I think it's just a basic info that you guys could kind of absorb, and I'll show you links of where to find this information in the future. And I could actually, I'll tailor it more towards you guys because I have a PowerPoint that can kind of help high school counselors, and I'll send it to Dr. Joseph.
And I can post it, that'd be great.
So these are the educational benefits and the percentage that's used in California, probably across the nation. So this is the post 9/11 GI Bill, the one that I used afterwards that paid tuition and fees, as well as the housing stipend. The original GI Bill didn't, it just paid the like a little small housing stipend. The selective reservist for current reservists, and that's terrible. It'll pay tuition and fees, gives them like $300 a month or something crazy like that, like gas money, I don't know. Vocational rehab, I basically use most of these GI Bill. I used the original 30 when I was ITT Tech. I used post 9/11 until I almost finished it, and now I'm under vocational rehabilitation for the VA. So I'll kind of explain that one later. And then there's a couple of dependent education benefits. So what I just realized I forgot to put one. But CalVet fee waiver. So another thing that you guys may or may not be aware is that dependents, children, and spouses could qualify for education benefits. So you may be talking to somebody that is a child of a vet that can use benefits in college. So the CalVet fee waiver, so general points that apply to education benefits, VA determines eligibility for CalVet of course, and then you could be eligible for more than one benefit, but you can only use one at a time. Most chapter benefits are 36 months, depending on if you use one and then ended up using the rest, you could qualify up to 48 months. They give you a certificate of eligibility, which you take to the school, and then the school has to be listed as the primary school. And this is just, yeah. So the VAH is the housing stipend. It's E5 with dependent right now in California. So that depends on state because the cost of living. So here right now it's $2,500 a month if they go full-time the whole month. It's not bad, right? Chapter 30, like I said, original GI, I don't know why that's so tiny. Right now for full-time, oh, $1,700 when I was using those, $1,000, so there you go. 36 months, expires 10 years. Like I said, Congress is talking about making that longer. And then they have to certify, blah, blah, blah. It's way too much info for you guys, I'm sorry.
Yeah, but they can use it, they can just take it back with them and just...
Yeah, so book rehab, you have to have a service-connected disability. So meaning something happened to you in the military and they rate you by percentage. It was 10%, it went back up to 20. So ignore that 10% outfit. but the length of benefits depend on the course of study. So they could you're assigned a book rehab counselor, you go through this orientation, you go through this thing. If they're gonna pay for school, you have to say what you wanna be. So basically you're looking actual job titles and then depending on what's needed for the job, like a master's degree, bachelor's degree, that's what they'll allow you to do. So then they pay the school and you to go to school, basically. It's a great program. They pay for our parking, which is like getting ridiculous here at Cal State. Mm-hmm. Do you guys have to pay for parking?
Yep.
Oh, okay. So they pay for our parking, which is pretty amazing, and books, and they give us $50 supply at the bookstore for like pens and stuff. Yeah. It's not bad. It was a pain in the butt to get. That's a story for another time, but it basically took me 2 years to get book rehab, so the VA is pretty horrible. But I can't complain. It was worth the fight for me. It's going to my master's, and they approved my PhD, so. Yeah. I'm sure when the time comes for me applying, they're going to make me go through this process again, and I'm 2 years. suit gives us a complete ed plan once we start across majors. That doesn't really happen necessarily. And so I use that as a template for our counselors here, because when these students were on Volk Rehab, they said, I don't know, how could they want an ed plan? They haven't even started. Like, how can I get them? We don't know what's transferred in and blah, blah. You know, and so I developed this template for them to help the vet, because it has their upper GE themes and all the stuff that a CSU requires. So that's just a sample. And then, so post 9/11, you only qualify if you were in after 9/11. Depending on how long you were in, that's how much they give you. If you're a reservist, then you get deployed during right now time of war, then they could award you up to so many months, depending on how long you're there. So same thing, certificate of eligibility, they certify with the school, there's a certifying official at every school, or they're supposed to be, and they certify their enrollment. The classes have to be going towards a degree. Like I said, there's the reserve GI Bill, doesn't pay any tuition, just gives them a stipend. Tuition assistance is actually branch specific, so depending on the branch, and that's not done through the certifying official, that's done with the DOD, Department of Defense, so they communicate with cashiers. So it gives them so much to go to school if they're currently in. So any kids or spouses of vets may qualify for CalVet fee waivers, the most common one that they might qualify for. Also, if the vet rates post 9/11, that one that pays the tuition and the school fees and the housing, they can opt to give it to a kid, but they have to do it before they get out. So before they discharge, they have to do the paperwork. Yeah, and that's something they don't tell them. So often I have parents contact, when I worked at the Veterans Research Center, I would have vets contacting me like, I'm trying to give this to my kid. I'm like, did you do it before you got out? They're like, no, they didn't tell us. They said we could do it afterwards, and they can't. So that's gone. That option's gone. If the vet doesn't go to school, like, that's gone. But this, the CalVet fee waiver is for spouses and kids. So basically it waives tuition, not school fees, to any California Community College and state university, so not private schools. But as long as they're taking state supported classes, it'll waive their tuition and they just gotta pay the school fees. When the student applies to CalVet. The DEA is it doesn't pay tuition, it's a stipend that's given. The vet has to be 100% total and disabled to be eligible for the student. And then they just give them the stipend every year. If you guys, if you go on the Veterans Resource Center page at Cal State LA, it has all the education benefits. So all this information is there. I don't know how often it's been updated. I haven't talked to the director in some time, but all the benefits are there. And so you could kind of see, you know, how they work. And I don't know if it goes into complete explanation, but it gives you the...
But it would be nice if you have a kid who's thinking about it, just to let them know that there are resources that they need to look at now before they go, rather than when they leave.
Yeah, so almost every school now, even the community colleges, are getting veterans resource centers. They definitely want to connect with them because they'll show them how to use their benefits. And they'll have just other information for, like, for instance, there's vet centers. Those are counseling offices. They're part of the VA, but they don't share their information with the VA. These were created after Vietnam because Vietnam vets had a distrust from the VA. Vets in general, because we got to fight them on every single thing. So we don't care for the VA too much. Although I love the Long Beach VA hospital. I go there and they're awesome. They have like all new doctors, all new facilities. I love it. But in general, vets don't really trust the VA. So there's the vet centers were created for counseling services. So as long as you served overseas, they'll give you free services for you and your family. It's pretty nice. So you can find out all this kind of, they could get hooked up with the resources by going to a Veterans Resource Center. So you'll be knowledgeable on benefits and information, or at least connecting them to the right people is gonna be really, really helpful. The students are not often aware of the benefits, so the more you know, the more you can help them, and then contacting or putting them in contact with the right folks, right? That's like the main thing.
When you say the Cal State is a pay first, is they have to you have to pay and then you get paid back?
Okay, so for education benefits, it depends. Okay, so like I was talking about the certificate of eligibility, if the benefit pays tuition, you have that certificate of eligibility, you bring it to the school certified official. So it makes, she puts in the system that you have something paying your tuition, like a third party payer. So a lot of these companies will pay tuition. It's basically like that. It's a third-party payer. So you don't have to pay up front. But if you get a benefit that doesn't pay tuition, yeah, you have to pay up front. For CalVet fee waivers, because the school fees are not paid, they have to pay those before they can register. It's like $442 right now per term. So what are some issues? May need some financial aid. Often our vets too, and you guys have heard the funny, you know, divorce rate and people just get married. I got married in the military. Long story. We didn't have any kids or anything like that, so we're like best friends. We're still legally married. Long story. Yeah, he's gay. It's funny. It's a great story. he's weird in the Marine Corps again. So most, so a lot of people get married either out of love or just to feel like they have someone to come home to, I guess, maybe. And so a lot of them are supporting dependents when they go back to school. You know, so we're definitely not the traditional student, much older, with kids, you know, different, living at home with mom and dad and that kind of thing. So, I mean, hopefully. So a lot of us are academically rusty when we go back, but we haven't been there for a while, and then might have some mental, physical disabilities. Resident status, like I said, a lot of them will discharge out of California and stay here and then try to go to school and are charged non-resident fees. So, there's that. This is just we have a couple veteran clubs on campus, the National Honor Society, and then the Veterans Club that any student can join, vet or not. And then that's it. I have some more helpful slides that I did. I did a counselor update for community college and high school counselors. Mm-hmm. And I wish I would have asked you, the audience, before.
So when we read an article pro or con, you know, recommending that kids go into the military, what do you think are some reasons why some kids should go into the military?
If they don't have like a course of action after high school, you know, I myself have a bunch of nephews and nieces that do not want to go to college. And what are you gonna do? Go get a part-time job working at Burger King, or like, what are you gonna do with a high school diploma? You know, we're in a credentialized society. I mean, I would say for any kid that's unsure, when I joined, there was no conflict. You know, so that wasn't even in my head. Now you know going in, you know you're going to get deployed most likely. So it's a different time era. But I would say any kid who doesn't really know or doesn't have a great family like support system, you know, mom and dad or maybe just one parent or, you know, just to get out and give themselves opportunities and kind of see the world. That's one of the reasons I joined, to travel, to not live at home with mom and dad. just because I didn't see any other opportunities, and I don't ever regret it, you know.
Did anyone in high school ever talk to you in depth about your decision, whether, you know, to weigh the pros and cons, or?
No.
Nobody?
My recruiter was he was good. I mean, he was good, but one thing I really appreciate about him, looking at it back at it now, is that he was so brutally honest with me. He's like, you're a woman, you're going to have to work twice as hard, and when you get promoted, people are going to say, who did she sleep with? Like, he was very frank with me, and I appreciated it. And the problem with that is that's not done enough. And so my first week in boot camp, I think every girl was breaking down crying because they just did not expect that. And he prepared me for boot camp. So I was like, what are you crying? I was like, it's the Marine Corps. Where did you think you were going? Like, the Girl Scout? Like, the Girl Scouts? Or the Girl Scouts? Like, what's... So I didn't, but he prepared me so well. But as good as he prepared me, the sexism eventually got to me. Like, I was like, it don't matter what I did, it was never there. And I give a lot of props to women who stay in the military, especially Marine Corps. I'm like, wow, I mean, the stuff you gotta deal with to hear, and fairly early, you know, when a female get promoted, oh, who was she, you know, blah, blah, blah. Like, oh my God, it's just, much. I just think.
Do you ever speak to high school students?
I haven't yet, but I just became a recruiter not too long ago, so yes, I'm looking forward to it. You guys want me in your classroom?
So she's not recruiting for military. She's recruiting for people to come to
college,
consider being teachers.
Yes.
And counselors.
Disclaimer.
Disclaimer, not the military. We hired her in our office of student services to recruit up for us students who want to be teachers and counselors. She's perfect for that job.
Yes. So thinking about this idea of children who have a parent, so they're considered dependents, what I'm wondering what the high school counselors here could possibly do to like maybe identify those kids, or
you know, it's
important so they know what they could possibly access.
I don't think that's a problem even at the college level, is that we don't know of them until they come to us. So what we did, I don't know if you guys know about Cal State LA Preview Day, where they're like maybe considering coming here or not. It's like the last final thing to like reel them in. What we did from the Veterans Resource Center, we put, is your parent a veteran? You may get tuition waiver. I don't know what we put. And then Eric would just flock there. Like, people were like, what? Because they weren't aware of the benefits. Unfortunately,
if they're doing a financial aid night, what they could do is have a session. If your parent was in the military, mm-hmm. we're going to cover it in our financial aid.
That would be super helpful. And
you know, just put it as part of your, you know, if we will talk about veteran benefits.
Mm-hmm. That would be really great. And financial aid's good about collaborating with the Veterans Resource Center here. But like I said, I haven't been there for a couple of months, and I don't know. I don't have a great relationship with any director, so I don't know. I don't know what's going on over there. But yeah, really, I guess just asking them when you have a new class, you know, seniors, maybe you want to ask them, like, hey, did anybody's parents, you know?
Well, that could be on your questionnaire.
You know?
If that's on your intake questionnaire, is one of your parents in the military? Mm-hmm. And do they serve overseas, right? Because they have to have served overseas for some of them. I don't know, you could just find out right there on your questionnaire.
And then that would just lead to, hey, apply.
Right.
Apply,
yeah.
Apply for benefits, apply for Calvin, apply for VA.
First one.
But the parent has to have designated that.
No,
right, before they leave.
No.
So
that's two different things, I think.
Two different things.
Yeah. The only, yeah, just that one GI Bill.
Oh, okay.
The other, like the Calvin fee waiver and the DEA, just depends on eligibility. So I just tell them apply, just apply.
So the parent and the child can benefit from it?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very smart. I'm assuming in a lot of our neighborhoods we have a lot of vets.